Next on CreARTivity, we have an artist who works exclusively with the art of comics. Stay tuned. Welcome to CreARTivity. This is your host, Lou McNally. From the newspaper's funny pages to the silver screen, comics have evolved completely into their own artistic medium. And recently, they've grown largely outside the classic demographic and into the society's mainstream culture. And today, we've got a guest who continues this legacy. His name is Nathan Wiedemer. And Nathan, welcome to the show.
Thanks a lot for having me.
How are you doing today?
I'm doing great.
Thanks. Now, tell me how long you've been doing this, first of all.
Since I was about 9 years old.
9 years old.
Yep.
Now, what was it that got you started at nine? Was it Batman?
A couple issues of Batman, a couple issues of Superman, but really the newspaper strips were what really caught
just
me.
Just the regular old daily comic strips?
Yep. Peanuts, Calvin and Hobbes, and then when I got a little bit older, Bloom County. But the comic books also had a big influence.
I'll bet they did, because look at the results of what we got here. Now, did you study anywhere for this kind of work, or did you figure it out yourself?
Figured out myself, but I also had a lot of great friends and influences. A lot of people came along in my life at the right time. So all the way through high school, I've had a good stable of older artists that kind of helped show me a little bit of the way. And
this is all around here?
In Orlando, yeah, and a lot of the comic book conventions, and even just a sketch group I've been going to for about 10 years now.
Tremendous. Well, we've got a lot to talk about, and I'm sure there'll be a lot of questions, so we wanted to remind the viewers out there that if you do have a question for Nathan, you can call in. Call in right now if you'd like at 1-800-901-9238. That number again is 1-800-901-9238 if you have a question for Nathan about comics. And, well, let's get started. I mean,
okay.
I'm going to pick up this one right here. We have a whole pile of them back here.
Yep.
This is my favorite of what I've seen so far.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, is the epitome of a really good old-fashioned comic. You've got great characters, and you've got a tremendous storyline going in there, which I would say, story or character or art first?
Oh, story first. And
story
then
first.
The characters sort of come out of that, and then they guide the story. So, you know, you come up with an idea for a story, and then the characters tell you if they want to do that or not.
Oh, the characters will tell you that as you draw them. Well, that's fascinating. Now, you've also got a couple of different formats here, different sizes. Are these run by a publisher, or is this something that you're doing?
Oh, no. Me and my co-writer, Stephen Mangold, we self-publish all our own work right now. And then with our current work, it's actually an anthology. So when those are finished, the stories in the anthology are finished, we'll probably look for publishers.
Is that the way to go for the future now? I mean, to get your work out there? Musicians do that a lot. I mean, they basically do the recordings and get them out there themselves.
Yeah, I think, you know, DIY is sort of, it's becoming the standard bearer because it allows a lot of creative freedom, and you are actually allowed to make a lot of mistakes on your own and learn from them rather than having somebody give you a formula right away that you have to follow.
Well, now, we've had a lot of artists on the show so far, some of whom have had to come up with some pretty good-sized investments to get into the business. Not so much with comics, right?
Yeah, that's the great thing. You know, you just need a couple pencils, some ink, and some paper, and you're ready to make comics.
And off you go.
Yeah, you can get more expensive from that, and you probably will, you know, as you go along. But, yeah, just to start out. And then if you want to mass produce them, you just take them to a photocopier, and you can photocopy them, and
I
started.
Here we have an example. It's obviously a time lapse
of
you doing a, is that a whole page or single panel? Or?
That's a whole page, and that's series, same old story, and that series always has five panels per page.
So that page that you're doing there will actually end up with five separate little blocks and different sections of the story.
Yep.
How long from start to finish for something that size?
From start to finish, looking about a page a day, maybe two pages on a really good day.
Now, you have that pretty much set up in your head, what you're going to be doing?
Me and my co-writer, we kind of brainstorm everything out, and then he comes up with a script that's mainly dialogue and panel breakdown, and then he gives me a lot of creative freedom.
So it's up to you to make the characters react or act to that.
It's a lot like figuring out, you know, acting in terms of
how they
would respond and the various, you know, facial expressions you're going to give
them. Like directing a play, except mm-hmm. you can make it look exactly the way you want. And what happens if you get the facial expression just a little bit wrong?
And you erase it and you start over.
This is why you're working in pencil.
Exactly.
To get started.
It's a great medium for control freaks.
That's tremendous. Now, so you're saying it's actually the script and the story that's inspiring you to get this done.
Mm-hmm.
Are you taking any advice while this is going on, or has your co-writer given you the script and now you're doing the panel?
Yeah, he's given me the script, so once I get the script, it's my domain. I really get final say on what the page is going to look like.
Now, a couple of questions I have would be, number one, you have to leave room for the bubble.
Yeah, the world balloons and thought balloons, yeah.
Okay, so this one's going to be in color?
Yeah. When we'll actually scan that in and do the color in the computer.
Now, what about the anatomy of the characters? I mean, it's the same pretty much in every scene.
Yeah, you want to keep the anatomy consistent to the character, but you can pretty much make the designs as unique as your imagination will let you.
I've seen some of the designs you have here. You mentioned while we were talking earlier, this was one of your favorite
mm-hmm.
ones, right?
Yeah,
here.
Hallowtweens.
Hallowtweens.
Yeah.
Shoe fly die. But it is black and white, as you can see, mm-hmm. all on the inside
yeah.
of the thing. But you get a nice colored. Colored
and that's, yeah, that's, we're making the move into a lot more color stories. Initially, we were doing mainly black and white just for economical purposes, but now we're making the jump into color.
Well, I'm going to close this over so we can see the color right there. Mm-hmm. And there it is. Do you do the inking yourself, or do you send that out? I know some comic people do.
Mm-hmm, some do, but I do everything myself, from inking, lettering, and finished colors.
You have to think also about the reproduction down the other end.
Yeah, yeah.
So are you using computers to finish it off?
Yes, and that's with reproduction, you know, you just make sure that you factor things like lines are going to be thinner, so you on the original pieces, you're going to make them a little bit thicker. And then when you scan them in, you know, you can see, you can do, actually, the great thing with computers now, you can scan them in and print up dummy pages to see what they look like.
Well, let's take a look at the tools that you actually use.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, this is a riot, because we've had people in here with chainsaws and everything yeah. else, but so, that's it?
Yeah, that's what I start out with. I start out with a red pencil and a blue pencil.
Why do you use the two colors?
Because I'm doing layouts, if I put in just red, it's going to become a big blow of red. So I use the two colors to differentiate the layout.
I get you.
And then when I'm done doing the layout,
yeah.
I go in and I do the rough pencils
okay.
with just pretty much any standard pencil I can get my hands on at the time. And then I go in with my inking tools, which is an ink brush and then a couple of these different sized microns. And
to outline the edges.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed something about those initial pencils, the little red and blue one. Mm-hmm. There's no eraser on them.
Yes, they have been completely utilized. Erased down to a nub.
All right, well, that sounds great. I imagine. Which one's out first, the eraser or the pencil? Looks like the eraser ran out first.
Yeah, the eraser always runs out before the pencil. But
all right, so I believe we have a phone call, and who is on the who's on the line? Hello, caller, are you there?
Yes, I am. This is Romeo.
Hello, Romeo. How are you tonight?
I'm doing just fine. How are you?
I'm fine. What's your question for Nathan?
The question for Nathan is, what are some of your favorite comics that you've done, and if any of these are available to the public or just for yourself?
Well, there you go. It's a couple
okay.
of good questions.
Yeah. Probably my favorite stuff is always my most recent stuff. So,
okay. Which would be what?
My most recent stuff would be the Hallowtweens that we just showed you.
Right, Hallowtweens.
And
yeah.
the Amazing Action Adventure Showcase.
The Amazing Action Adventure Showcase, ladies and gentlemen.
Which, it's an anthology, and it has three different stories, and they're all in color.
Are you setting that up for television down the road? I mean,
if people want to make an offer, I would entertain an offer.
I was also going to ask, too, the idea of putting it out in print, of course, is mm-hmm. one thing. But what about the web? And what about
you can
media?
Also. We have a website, and we actually are updating a lot of the stories on there. So you can see a lot of the stories that are in print here on our website at NathanandSteve.com.
NathanandSteve.com. Okay, well, that sounds good. These are some of the ones that you're working on now. It's a continuing, it's like Star Wars, right?
Mm-hmm. An ongoing saga.
Three different storylines going on at once. Now, there's an example of your work. I don't think I've ever seen that that brilliant yellow in a comic before.
Digital printing allows you a lot more colors than the classic palette has. So
you would... Now, that's a completely different palette, this one here.
Mm-hmm. It's two different stories, so you get two different palettes.
You get to choose the palette for each story. Are there colors that you need to stay away from because of reproduction?
Yeah, some colors just will come up muddy, so you have to be aware of that. They almost always print darker than they look on the screen.
This is a 6, 12, or 11 panel?
Yeah, that was a quick montage page that we had of a pretty vicious horseshoe match.
Okay. So in most instances, are you doing, four panels to a page or five, or is it just vary with the story?
It depends on the story. With same old story, we generally have five panels per page. And then with other stories like I Fight Everything and Kings of Sion, it really varies for the storytelling.
These
or
are
what's
other,
needed.
Are other books that you've done.
Yeah, those are the other two stories that are in Amazing Action Adventure Showcase.
Do you determine yourself who's going to have the big panel or where it's going to be on the page, or is it the story that determines that?
It's a little bit of both. Obviously, I'm always trying to walk in service of the story, so that's why I walk in so many different styles.
Now, you get this out by, of course, word of mouth, and I think Romeo was also asking, are these available to the public?
Yes. You can actually pick them up from Steve and I personally at a lot of different conventions, but you can also get them at indieplanet.com, which is the people that we self-published through.
Through, okay.
Yeah, they're a printer, but they also will mail books out because they do print on demand.
Now, you mentioned conventions. I mean, how many of them are there, really?
Oh, there are more every year, honestly. A lot of smaller conventions in Orlando now. The biggest one is obviously the MegaCon convention.
MegaCon, we've heard of that. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Now, do you end up with... Oh, we got some more graphics coming up here. This is pretty futuristic.
Yeah, that's actually sort of a very loose sci-fi retelling of the first book of Samuel.
No kidding. Well, there may be a market for that out there, particularly this time of year. That's amazing. Now, you really are kind of staying in the black and white.
Well, it all starts with black and white, and then I get to decide if I want to add color to the piece or not. And some pieces I like in black and white, and some pieces I would like to see in color.
I think that color work is just spectacular.
Thanks.
I love those three characters. Who are they?
That is Nate, Nick, and Gwen.
Nate, Nick, and Gwen. Well, we're taking a look here. Also, it looks like at some of the tools of your trade, right there. Now, at these conventions, do you run into the big guys? I mean, you run into the Doonesburys and people like that? Or?
Well, not so much like Doonesbury. He's a comic strip guy, and they have their own conventions and their own conferences.
Oh, wait, the comic strip guys are different?
Yeah. There's two different tribes.
These are the people that would have the regular strip in the paper and then the colored strip on Sunday. So they're a different genre than the comic book these days.
It's just a different industry, different circles. But the comic book guys, we all pretty much are in the same room together, and we all know each other. It's a very small community.
Look at
in
that
the end.
Look, that's just so intricate, really. And these panels, you're saying, take how long?
It's about one page a day to two pages a day on a really good day.
And there could be four or five panels in each page.
Oh, more.
Or more.
Yeah.
My goodness. Would you put the whole thing out in black and white and then colorize it, or put the colors as you go?
We'll do that with some of the stories, like the Halloweens. We are putting them out in black and white first, but then when we collect them all, we'll probably do a color version.
So when you're writing comic books these days, you and your colleagues, you see at the conventions, do you have basic characters that you stick with and try to develop, like a writer for a play would?
Yeah, it depends on the creator, obviously, but that's how we approach it. We definitely work with long-term narrative in mind. So eventually we would like all our stories to be longer narratives, so either a couple...
12, 14 volumes.
Yeah.
I get the picture now. Now, what would happen if you were offered a publishing gig instead of self-publishing?
Oh, yeah, we definitely would entertain it. But that's part of the reason why we want to actually do the walk and publish the walk ourselves first, because it kind of gives you a stronger negotiating hand to.
Now, tell me a little bit about your work in illustrations, just individual panels. Mm-hmm. Is there a business, you know, for that out there?
There is with, spot out and a lot of commissions. I get a lot of commission work of just people wanting personal illustration work.
I was thinking, greeting cards maybe or something mm-hmm. like that?
Greeting cards, spot illustrations in magazines, really even just product illustrations. I do a lot of game design work.
Now, I know there's a lot of editorial cartoonists out there, some mm-hmm. very famous over the years, and there's been some editorial cartoonists, and not just Doonesbury, but Walt Kelly with Pogo, for example.
Pogo is
very, slanted in one direction. Do you ever find yourself having your characters kind of head one way politically or religiously or?
We mostly try to really just keep it entertaining, but since it is an extended narrative and it's two guys talking, your worldview is going to come out in that. But times it's also the character's worldview, so it would be something that we wouldn't necessarily agree with, but we find interesting and would like to do a character that sort of has that worldview.
You mentioned at the beginning that you had a number of mentors and colleagues that you could work with here in Central Florida. Mm-hmm. Now, is this kind of a hotbed here, or is it?
I don't know if I would call it a hotbed. I know Portland has a lot, a big community.
Portland, Maine, or Chicago. Oregon?
Oregon.
Oregon, okay.
Yeah. but Orlando's actually growing. We're getting a lot more conventions, and there are a lot more local artists that are getting in and realizing, I can do that.
I'd like to show the folks some of these larger panels here. Mm-hmm. Why don't you pick one out that we can bring up? This is the actual panels, the size that you work with, right?
This is a 11 by 17.
11 by 17 panel. Okay, I'll hold it up right here. So this is is this a finished work here?
Yeah, this would be an illustration piece.
An illustration, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now that would be for, you mentioned the word spot illustration mm-hmm. a couple of minutes ago. What was it, just one at a time?
Yeah, or just like the things that you would see in the corner of a magazine. This would be a full page illustration.
Okay, now this would be not so much inspired, but more commissioned, right? Because it's attached to a story.
Yeah, well, this is actually for a series. I was doing a series of fake paperback novels.
So,
I was doing a whole bunch of different styles, and that was one of those.
There's an interesting dude right here. What's his name?
That is General Hodgepodge.
General Hodgepodge, not to be confused with General Chaos, I'm sure.
And it was actually the cover for my sketchbook, which was full of hodgepodge. So.
Oh, I get it. Well, it works as an illustration, too. In terms of the business itself, yes, you are self-publishing, and yes, it would be great if DC Comics called tomorrow or something, but where do you see both your work and the work of comic book illustrators going?
Well, I think there's definitely a growing market for it, and a lot of people that really appreciate the art for what it is. And there's much more appreciation for it than I would say even 20 years ago.
Really?
Just because people don't look down on it as much. 20 years ago, there would be a lot of, comics are for kids, and now a lot more people realize that comics are for everyone.
Mm-hmm. There's a term that you use in your field called sequential art, mm-hmm. you mentioned before. What is that?
Sequential art is pretty much any series of illustrations that tell a narrative or a story.
In the process.
Yeah, so it can be comics, or it can be storyboards for a movie, or storyboards for advertising, anything like that.
Now, there were some fads in animation that went zipping by here over the last 20, 40 years. Anime is one mm-hmm. that comes to mind. What happens to those? Do they just go back down into a small cult?
No. Anime is still big. It still has a huge following here in America. May not have the shine it used to, but that's the good thing is, that allows the cream to rise to the top.
Well, I do know people that have actually named their children after people in anime movies, so it's pretty popular, I guess. But the rest of it, where's it going to go?
Oh, well, if I knew that, I'd be rich.
Well, let me ask you something else. All of these, of course, are still illustrations. Mm-hmm. They're not moving.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see yourself moving into animation at all with these? Into real, you know, into moving cartoons?
Yeah, not so much with these. I think there's a real intimacy that can be developed from, you know, a single page narrative that, you know, doesn't flash at you. It's like reading a book where, you know, a book is much more intimate than, you know, going to a movie.
Gotcha. In terms of your commission work as an artist, what does that consist of? Could somebody come say, I want you to just do a one-off copy of a comic book that has my mother-in-law in it?
They could. That would cost a lot of money.
Well, it sure would. Which brings up the question, can you make a living at doing this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of people do. And, you know, I make a good portion of my living from it.
Well, there you go. All right. That sounds fascinating to me. Have you thought about branching out into other forms of art, like painting and portraits and photography and airbrushing and all the other things we've had on the show?
Yeah, well, I've done caricatures with airbrush. I've done, I do a lot of game design right now.
Game design? Mm-hmm. What do you mean?
Well, for me, game design is actually about the arcade units that you would see at the arcade. So I actually get to do the box art and a lot of the actual physical elements that operate within the gameplay.
That is fascinating. So you're not actually talking about, you know, designing the game itself?
Oh, that as well.
Really?
Yep, from A to B.
Well, that makes sense, I suppose. But that's 3D, isn't it? I mean,
Sometimes it is, but I would be working up the concepts and the storyboards that are involved in that.
Well, now, you mentioned at the conventions, actually not at the conventions, these strip guys have other conventions from you. Do you ever see yourself going over to the dark side there and publishing in the newspaper?
I mean, that was my dream as a kid, but unfortunately, newspapers aren't as strong as they used to be, so it's a very exclusive market now.
What does it take to break into that syndication?
A lot of persistence, a lot of banging your head against the wall, and knowing the right people.
Sounds like just about anything else in art.
Yeah.
Which brings up the question, when you get to these conventions, how is your art received by other artists?
Oh, well, it depends on the artists. You know, some artists think I'm, you know, way too cartoony, and I'm not serious enough.
Really?
But for
hello most, tweens?
Yeah.
How could they possibly think that?
But a lot of other artists realize that, you know, it's a lot of fun and they enjoy my work a lot.
Great. Well, we got another viewer on the line who's interested to know something. Hello, caller, are you there?
Hi, Lou, I am here. I have a question for Nathan. Nathan, if you could collaborate with any other comic book artist in the world, who would it be?
Wow. Mm. Who would your favorite collaborator be?
That'd be tough. I'm working with the guy that I enjoy collaborating with the most, but if I got to work with a legend, maybe it would be I'd say Berkeley Breathe of Bloom County.
Berkeley Breathe. That's how you pronounce his name?
Yeah. I almost went with Bill Watterson, but I think he might be difficult to work
with. Well, Berkeley did he did Bloom County, and Watterson did which one?
Calvin and Hobbes.
Calvin and Hobbes. So Doonesbury doesn't do anything for you, or Shoe, or anything like that?
Doonesbury, I like a lot of the college strips.
The college strips.
From the 70s, yeah.
Are you going to be able to continue that feel all the way through your career, or do you see yourself changing?
Oh, I hope I change. I don't want to remain stagnant.
Oh, well, good. I would love to know if you've got a superhero in mind to develop down the road.
Oh, yeah. I definitely have a superhero story.
Can you let that out?
His name is Max Atlas.
Max Atlas.
Yep, and it actually follows the from the 20s all the way into the new millennial. It's sort of a story of the last half of the 20th century.
So are superheroes still cool in the comics?
Oh, yeah.
There's still a market for
that. There's still plenty of superhero fans out there.
Now, what about the actual books themselves? Do we find the same size? Are they getting standardized or...?
Largely the same size. Probably the biggest change over the years have been the move towards trade paperbacks and hardbacks.
Gotcha. All right, we have one more phone call and time to squeeze that in. Caller, are you there?
Yes.
Hello, and what's your question for Nathan tonight?
Yes, I wanted to find out what some of his inspirations are. I know some of his artwork reminds me of Ren and Stimpy. I was wondering if that was an inspiration.
Well, yeah, I could see some of that in the haircut here.
Yeah.
We'll put that back up.
No, animation is a huge influence, and the animation guys like John Kay, who is the creator of Ren and Stimpy, and Bill Ray, who did a lot of the background paintings, was a big influence, and Bob Camp, who was the director, and Bruce Timm also.
You figure you can do this for the rest of your career?
Well, I hope so. Nobody can predict the future.
That's the idea. That's the plan. What's your favorite animated cartoon on television or cable or history or?
Right now that's running right now. I really enjoy Gravity Falls and Adventure Time.
What about the old time cartoons? What's your favorite?
Oh, I love the classic Looney Tunes.
Bugs Bunny or Popeye?
Bugs Bunny.
Bugs Bunny.
He's the Groucho Marx of cartoons.
Wasn't he ever. So let's know. All right, well, I wish you luck in the rest of your career, and I think it's wonderful that this is actually developing and building up here in Orlando. Do you see that continuing right here?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. It's, right. I think in Orlando it's only going to get bigger.
We'll have to look for a convention soon. But thank you very much for stopping by. We're running out of time real quickly here. That's our show. We'd like to thank Nathan for coming in, showing us his art, and that he enjoys so much, and that we do too. We hope you enjoyed it as well. If you have any questions that didn't get answered, feel free to email us, wdsc@daytonastate.edu. That's wdsc@daytonastate.edu. And if you want to see more of Nathan's work, you can do so by visiting bluerosestudios.net. That's bluerosestudios, just like it sounds, .net. Thanks for watching. Till next time, it's CreARTivity. See you then.